Hi everyone, it's Kate from Minerva, and in today's sew along, I'm going to be making the Style Arc Adeline dress. This is a really pretty dress that's ideal for summer, and I think you can be dressed up to go to work or for a casual Sunday lunch or a trip to the shops, whatever you like. Let me show you the dress and the line drawing. So here's the style picture and here's the line drawing here. You can see that it has a front V neckline, it's got patch pockets, it's got fold-up cuffs, and there's quite a few facings to make as well. So we use facings to finish off the front and the back neckline, but also on the hem, because it's cut in quite a curved shape. So I think that lends a really nice touch to the dress as well. And of course, there's patch pockets. You can buy style-up patterns from Minerva on paper format, of course, and they are a little bit different from some other patterns. They come in one envelope, which contains the line drawings, as well as the pattern pieces, and all the instructions on one page. So in a way, that's quite convenient because you only have the one piece of paper to be dealing with. In terms of fabric, I think that this will look really nice in something with both drape and body. And for me, that basically means linen. I've got this really beautiful blue color here. I love linen and I love blue. It's one of my favorite colors and I think it will make up really, really nicely. When I say body and drape, what you choose will just affect how the final garments look. So if you choose, for example, a cotton poplin, then the shape will be more defined and it will look more structured. Equally, if you choose a viscose, you'll probably lose the beauty of the cocoon shape. So for me, it's about finding the balance and also just personal preference on how you want something to look. In terms of the other supplies, you'll need some interfacing. So there's one I really, really like from Minerva, which I've tagged below. And of course you'll need your matching thread and you'll need your sewing needles. I think that's it. So with that, I think we can go to the sewing machine and get started. Before we start sewing the dress together, there's quite some preparation work to do. So I've just gone through and prepared my facings and my pockets, and I've overlocked everywhere where necessary. So you can see on the pocket, I've just gone all the way around, and then we are going to fold it over. So right sides together, fold it over. And we're actually going to make a line of stitching along here. So if you don't know where the fold is, you can go back to your pattern piece and just identify where the notch is on either side. Okay, so for both pockets, we're going to make a line of stitching down here. The next piece is the front and the back hem facings. They look quite similar, so I've just put a bit of tape to mark which one is the front, and then I've overlocked on the top edge here. And you can see that everything is interfaced as well. So I've tagged the interfacing from Minerva in the video. The next one is the back facing. So you need one piece of this, and as you can see, it's also interfaced. And I've just put a line of overlocking all around the outer edge. And finally, the front facing, you can see here, it comes in two pieces because of this V, and I've overlocked the outside edge of both of them. Now to join them together, you put them right sides together, so you can see they're interfaced as well. I'm just going to pop a pin in, a couple of pins. And then we're going to put a line of stitching with a 1 centimeter seam allowance from here down to here so that we create one facing. This is the front facing sewn together now, and I can just take my scissors and trim this down slightly so it doesn't stick out. And then that's the front facing complete. And now I can join it together with the back facing. So I'm going to take my back facing and place it right sides together, and then pin and sew at the shoulder seams like this. Okay, so we're just going to make lines of stitching here. With the pocket,
Here is where I have sewn the flap over. And now I'm just going to turn it out. So I'm going to turn it out to the other side. And I'm going to grab a point turner. You can get one of these from Minerva. And open out the pocket here like so. So now you can see that here the piece wants to move in, and that's what you want to do. You want to press it down at 1 centimeter on both sides and then also on this edge down here. The other thing you might want to do is to secure this flap by making a line of stitching along here. So the final pocket ends up looking something like this with a line of stitching across. Now you can go and put it onto the dress, and on the front piece of your dress, you'll see that there are markings for where you need to put your pocket. In this case, I've marked in chalk actually here and here. So I know that the top of the pocket goes on the dress like so. Okay, there's a couple of ways that you can line up your pockets. You can just use pins like normal and then pin them on. But I actually like to use a product called Wonder Tape, which you can also get from Minerva. And this is just double-sided tape for fabric. So let me demonstrate. I can just cut a little bit off. And I am going to stick it, for example, to the top edge where I'm going to stitch down the pocket. And then I can take it off, take off the cover. So you see I still have some tape there. And so this is sticking on both sides. So now I can just place it on my dot again. Press it down a bit and then it's stuck. So this is not a permanent stick, so you can take it off quite easily as well and reposition if you don't get it right the first time. So I'm just going to put a bit of Wonder Tape all the way around pocket where I'm going to stitch it down. And this will just help hold everything in place when I put it together. When you're putting on patch pockets and you want to make sure your edges are exactly straight, there's a couple of things that you can do. The first one is to mark a line of chalk where you're attaching the pocket to, so that you know that you have to line up your pocket exactly with that line. So I'm going to do that. And then the other thing is that because I'm using Wonder Tape, I can choose where I want to stick my pocket, because you can move the tape. And then it's really useful to take a ruler and just put it next to the pocket so that you can see. So for example, here, it's sticking out a little bit too much at the edge, so I can just kind of push it back in. And this is why it's handy to actually just draw a line so that you can see where you're going. I just wanted to mention the direction of stitching as well when you stitch on a pocket. So normally you would put little triangles here and here to reinforce when you put your hand in so that you don't rip up the stitches. So I'm going to draw it in a large scale so you can see it, but effectively you're going to start about here. Going to move up, that's number one, and then you leave your needle down, pivot, that's number two, and then number three, all the way down here, and then you go around, obviously, and when you get to the other side, you stop at the top, you go across a few stitches, and then you go down. Normally, I would go about 3 stitches on the top of this triangle here, but again, I've just drawn this into a large scale so that you can see it. Once your pockets are on, you can turn your attention to the back piece here. Now, for the front, we cut this on the fold so that there's not a seam showing. But here, the pattern is drafted such that there is a two-piece back, one on either side, and you join it together at the center back seam. I think this is done for economy reasons, fabric economy reasons, but if you had a pattern to match or you didn't want that seam to show, you could always cut this on the fold as well. You would just need to take off the 1 centimeter seam allowance from your center back piece, just trim it off, and then cut it on the fold. However, in this case, I did not do that. So I'm going to have a two-piece back and I am going to just put the backs right side together and then make a line of stitching here. So again, here's one of my back pieces. And I'm just going to put the other one on top, right sides together. My fabric doesn't really have a right side or wrong side, but if yours does, then please make sure you pay attention to that. And then I'm just going to pin and stitch the center back seam. This is my center back seam complete now, and all I've done is I've sewed up the center back seam with a 1 centimeter seam allowance. I have overlocked it and pressed it over to one side. And now we can turn our attention to joining the shoulder and the sleeve seams. So this is a grown on sleeve. So this is all one piece as part of the body. And this is the back neckline here. I think it's important to point out at this stage that there are quite a few notches on the sleeve. So please pay attention to those because you'll need them later. And also that this is actually not in a straight line. So if I look at my pattern piece, you can see there's a slight curve and then here are all the notches. So there's 1, 2, 3, 4 fairly evenly spaced apart and then one at the 1 centimeter mark here. So now I'm going to join together with the front body and I am simply placing my front body, right sides together against the back shoulder and neckline. So we're going to pin this one together on both sides and stitch it down. There are also the same notches on the front, so the 4 evenly spaced and the one that's 1 centimeter from the raw edge. So you can match those up as you pin. I pinned the other side now and here are the 4 notches plus the one towards the at the raw edge of the hem. I think it's important to note here that you can see on the close-up that this is actually cut at an angle. So my advice would be to be a little bit cautious with handling your fabric and just be very gentle with it so it doesn't stretch out. If you feel like it is stretching, you can also just cut strips of interfacing and apply them sort of fairly close to the edge and then stitch over it. And this will stop this from stretching, so you can also do that if you want to. But let me just finish showing you what I've pinned. So this is one side, there's my center back seam, this is the V-neck of the front, and then I've just continued pinning on the other side. Here is the neckline. I've sewed the shoulder seams together, which is this one, and this is the V-neck of the front, and a slightly more rounded shape at the back, and this is the center back seam. Now, I've sewed the shoulders together and the sleeve again with a 1 centimeter seam allowance, and then I've overlocked it and I've pressed it towards the back. Now we're going to finish our neckline with the facing. So I explained earlier that we join the front and the back facing pieces together. So that's joined now at the shoulders. And you can also just give it a bit of a trim if you need to, so that when it's flat like this, these corners don't stick out. There's a couple of options here. Because I have pressed this seam allowance towards the back, I could actually press this seam allowance towards the front like this. And that way I've got an equal level of bulkiness in the back and the front, because one's pointing this way and the other seam allowance is pointing over here. So your final result would be something like this. And then of course you do the same on the other side. Once you're happy with your facings, then you can flip it over so it's right sides together and then pin. There is a center back seam here, so you could also just put a small notch in the back facing so that you know where the center back is and you can line that up. Just put that there. So now I know that this one, this notch here, aligns with the center back over here. So I'm just going to pop a pin there And then you of course need to line up the shoulder seams and the V. So just going to go and pin all the way around, first matching these important points and then filling in the gaps with the pins. Once you've finished pinning all the way around, so let me finish the front just to demonstrate. Okay, so once you finish pinning, you're going to sew all the way around the edge here, but you're going to use a 6mm seam allowance instead of a 1cm one. The last thing to note here is at the V point, it's quite useful just to take some chalk and make a mark where you're going to stitch, because it's quite hard to see when you've got this under the machine. So I like to just put a couple of chalk marks so I know exactly where I'm stitching. I'm going to stitch this first and then I'll trim down these excess little triangles. Here is the facing now stitched to the body. So I can go through and do some trimming so that it's not so bulky when I flip it over, including the little triangles at the V front. You can trim down, for example, these bits at the shoulder seam. And the other thing you might want to consider doing is, because the back has a curved edge, in order to get this to sit flat, you may also just want to trim where the curves are, just to release some tension, like so. So this is the back facing, and what this does is that when you go to flip it over on the inside, the seam sits a little bit nicer here. The next step in this process is to understitch now. So you're going to flip over the facing, or fold over the facing, and you're going to make a line of stitching on the facing and catch it to the seam allowance underneath it, which is this one here. And what this will do is that it will encourage the fabric to roll to this side, again, so that when you fold it over to the appropriate side, so this is the body and that's the facing, it won't be tempted so much to flip out. The other thing I'd like to draw your attention to is the issue of pressing. It's really good practice to press as you go, so when you finish a seam, then go and press it. So if you haven't done your shoulder seams, now is a good time to go and press those. When it comes to understitching, some people like to press before they understitch, so you'd fold over here and then press it. And some like to just understitch and then press it afterwards. There's no particular right or wrong answer. Like so many things in sewing, it's whatever feels good for you and whatever your preference is, and there's many ways to get a similar result. The other thing I wanted to show you here is the intersection here between the body and the facing. So I've got it fairly accurate, as you can see. And I'm showing you this because, again, this is about seam allowances and bulk. So I've pressed my facing seam allowances towards the front piece, which is on this side. That's the back piece. And on the body, on the shoulder seam, I've actually pressed it towards the back. And as I mentioned before, the reason is so that the bulk on this intersection is evenly distributed between the front and the back, and it feels fairly flat here. Had I pressed the seam allowance towards the back instead of the front, then that would have been a lot more bulky. Now, of course, you can avoid all of this if you wanted to, but at the beginning, that means that you would have had to overlock every piece separately before you sew them together. And then you would press everything open. So the facing would be open here. Instead of overlocking the seam allowance together, I would have overlocked that separately and then pressed it open. So there are many ways to do the same thing to achieve the same result. When I'm understitching, I use my foot as a guide. So you can see that there's a ledge kind of here. And then I'm just going to follow that ledge as I stitch. Okay, and then that gives me a line of stitching very close to the seam. I'll do a bit more so you can see it better. Okay, there it is, there. So you can see it's right next to the seam and it's caught the facing and also the seam allowance underneath it. If your foot doesn't have anything that will give you a good guide, you can also get a stitch in the ditch foot, which is actually a really useful one. Because if your machine can move needle positions, then you can put this piece of plastic in the seam, and then you can move your needle position to here, to here, to here, and then you can either stitch in the ditch or, you know, just next to the seam. Whatever suits your whatever you're stitching at the time, and it will give you a really perfectly even line of stitching compared to doing it by eye. Like I said, for me, because I have this particular foot, then it works just to do it by eye, but if you don't, then I would really highly recommend that you get something like this. So now I'm going to continue understitching. Now I'm reaching the front V point. So this is the facing, as you can see. And I'm actually going to stop my understitching about 3 centimeters before, because I'm not going to be able to stitch around this corner and keeping the seam allowances folded towards the facing and keep everything flat. You can stop a few centimeters before, like I'm doing, and this will still have fulfilled its function, which is to keep your facing from wanting to flip out. Here you can see my line of understitching. This is my V point. And now I'm also going to go over and release a bit of tension. So this is the V point. I'm just going to take a pair of scissors and snip very carefully on the body to about 1 millimeter before the stitching. And this will allow it to lie flat when you turn it over. So let me demonstrate. Okay, you see there's a little ripple there? It's probably because I didn't snip far enough. Okay, so I'm just going to go back in and do a tiny bit more. Again, don't snip through your stitching, but you need to get close. And then this should sort itself out with the iron. I'll show you that in a moment. This is my neckline. So I'll zoom out so you can see it in context. And this is my understitching now completed. You can see here. And then I'm just going to go over to the iron and then press everything really flat. Here is the finished facing and neckline, and you can see that the understitching is here, and I've just gone and pressed everything flat. To see it from the right side is here, and again a little press should get this tiny wrinkle out, but otherwise it's looking quite neat. Now if you're not a fan of facings flapping around when you wear them, there's a few options. One is to make a line of stitching, preferably from the right side, along the shoulder seams to anchor this facing in place. And that does a pretty good job. You can also put a label here and then stitch through the label, the facing and the front. Minerva have a great range of labels that you can buy as well. And the last thing you can do is also top stitch all around the edge. So if you do that, I'd recommend that you stay fairly close to the facing edge. But then that means that on the right side, instead of having kind of clean finish here, you will be able to see a visible line of stitching. So again, that's just personal preference and how you want your dress to look. You can see here in the pattern that they do actually put the line of stitching there as well. You will need to put the line of stitching at the hem because you need to attach the facings to the dress. So you don't really have a choice. Otherwise, your facing might just fall down and that wouldn't look very nice when you're wearing it. I'll show you that shortly. But yeah, here I think it's optional whether you want to put this line of stitching or not. To secure the facing at the shoulder seams, I usually just like to put my hand in it to see where the facing naturally wants to sit, because sometimes you'll find that the facing stitch line is not directly in line with the seam underneath it. Now, technically it should be, and I think in this case it is, but don't fret if it doesn't. As long as it's sitting flat, it's all fine. So I think the easiest way is to put your hand in the facing and see where it wants to sit, and then you can pop a pin on either side. You can feel where your facing actually ends, which is about there, and then I'm going to stitch in the ditch just from here until here, and I'll do that on both sides of the shoulders. I've put in those few stitch in the ditch stitches so you can barely see them. And I can take the pins out, and you can see on the wrong side that it wasn't exactly on this seam. Again, I'm okay with that. You're not really going to be paying too much attention to the, you know, whether this is 2 millimeters or 1 millimeter off. And I think that you should always do this kind of stitching on the shoulder seam when you've got facings so that they don't want to move around too much. And that's regardless of whether you want to put the line of top stitching on the outside or not. I think this back neckline is actually a really nice one to put in a label, and I've got this linen one by Cully and the Machine. It's also available for sale at Minerva, and I think I'm just going to pop it here, and I'm going to put a line of stitching over it here. So I've decided I don't want to have a visible line of top stitching here, but then if I put in the label, then that will just give me a few visible stitches along the back, but it will still help to hold down the back facing. And yes, I'm using linen. The label is in, so you can see it here, and there's a few visible stitches at the back, but it doesn't go all the way around. So now I'm just going to open up the dress again, so the right side is facing up, because then it's time to do the side seams. So we're going to do the sleeve and the side seams all in one hit. So it's a matter of flipping your dress. So I've just flipped the right side over so that it's basically inside out, and then pinning. So we're going to start pinning from the sleeve over here. And then here is the underarm seam. Let me just pop a few pins in now. Again, you'll have notches down here which you can match. This is on the sleeve. Then we're going to match the curve of the underarm. And then if you keep going along the side seam, so I've got a pocket here, there's actually a notch quite close to the pocket. So you can match that as well, the corresponding notch on the back piece. Okay, so there's the corresponding notch, so pin that. And then of course, the hem. So it is a high-low hem, thus the curve. So you will do that to both side seams and underarm seams. So now I've got the notches, I'm just going to go in and fill in the middle with pins. And you sew this with a 1 centimeter seam allowance followed by an overlock all the way around, and you do that on both sides. This is the side seam sewn and pressed now. So as I said before, it's your sleeve and your side seam all in one line of stitching. And as you reach the bottom, so you can see this is my center back, you can see that there should be a pretty smooth curve between your back piece and your front piece. Now we're going to turn the whole thing over so that it's right side out, and we're going to put on the facings. This dress features hem facings, and it's a really nice finish for a curved hem. So you can see I've overlocked the edges here, and I've just marked which one is the front because they can look quite similar. Having said that, the back facing has a double notch and the front facing has a single center notch. Now, the way to tell which way to lay them, you can have a look at your line drawing and also the pattern piece. So for example, you can see here that the front has, the center front is slightly higher than the side seam, and on the back it's the other way round. So you can just imagine how this would be on the dress in terms of which way you would overlock it, which edge you would overlock to start with. I'm going to stitch my hem facings together. So it's right sides together, and this is the shape. Again, if you're not sure, then just try pinning this to the dress to make sure you've got everything the right way around, and then you can go ahead and stitch it together. So again, you can refer to this diagram, which shows you which way the curves are meant to be facing. Now, when I pin, I'm just showing you that this is approximately 1 centimeter. I'm going to stitch this together with a 1 centimeter seam allowance, and you can see that there's a little bit of a triangle sticking out on both ends. So this is the 1 centimeter mark. And if I stitch it like this, instead of trying to line them up, when you open them up, you'll see that you have, or you should have, a reasonably smooth curve going from one piece to the other. Okay, so this is a bit roughly pinned, but you get the idea. So that's the reason why I'm not pinning, for example, like this. Here are the facings now stitched together, and here is the dress. This is the front piece, this is the back piece, and we know that it's the back because there is a center back seam here. Now, to figure out which way your facings go, I think it's always good to think how it would look if it was meant to be worn. So in this case, you would want to see the right side of the facing against the wrong side of the dress, like this. And similarly, on the inside, you would have the front facing and the front body like this. So then what that means is that when you stitch, you are going to stitch right sides together, and it will be something like this. So I'm just going to pin this one together at around the center back, and then I'm going to pin my side seams. So now on the body, I've pinned my seam allowance to the back. So on the facing, I'm going to press my seam allowances towards the front, so I achieve a flat finish. This is exactly the same as what I did on the neckline facings. So I'll put a pin there. And I'm going to do the same on the other side. So again, I've pressed my seam allowance towards the back. So here I'm going to press it towards the front. Okay. And then I'm going to look for the notches. So there is a notch at center front here, and there are double notches on either side at the on the back facing. So you can find those notches and then work all your way around pinning it and stitch it with a 1/4 seam allowance, 1/4 inch seam allowance, or 6 millimeters. When you're pinning, if you find that the curve is giving you problems because it feels like there's more fabric on the body than on the facing, you can also do what I've done and just make a few tiny snips within the 6 millimeter seam allowance. So these are probably only about 3 millimeters long, but the snips themselves, but this just releases a bit of tension so that it's a bit easier to ease in the curve of the body. As you can see here, so this one will stretch out a little bit more. This is the hem facing stitch to the dress, and this is my center back. So now we are going to understitch. So the hem facing is going to be folded downwards, and then you're going to stitch the hem facing to the seam allowance underneath. So you're going to stitch on the facing to the seam allowance. This is exactly how we did the neckline facing as well. So here you can see my corner is pretty good. This corner where the facing's joining is looking pretty good. So before I stitch, the final thing I'm going to do is just really trim down these seam allowances because they create unwanted bulk. So just grab your scissors and trim off those little triangles like so. Okay. And the same, of course, up here. The difference between the neckline allowance and the hem allowance is that after we've understitched, we're going to fold it back on itself and then put a line of stitching across here to hold the facing in place. Gravity is your friend on a neckline facing because it will pull the facing down, but gravity is going to make the facing flip out like this when you're wearing the dress. So it's important to actually just put a line of stitching to secure the facing. So unlike the neckline facing, there's probably not a lot of choice in this case to have a visible line of stitching. This is the understitching done now. You can see the line that's very close to the edge here. And I've also just pressed it. So my seam on the facing that joins the front and the back should be fairly well aligned with my side seam. If it's not perfect, don't worry about it. What matters more is that this sits perfectly flat. So if this is a bit not completely centered, don't panic, it's okay. And then to secure the facings, again, just like we did on the neckline, we are going to put a few stitches in the ditch here. So I like to pin it from the outside because that's where I'll be stitching. So you can see that's not perfectly aligned, but that's okay. And then finally do the line of stitching there. I know I just said that there's really no option except to have a visible line of stitching on the outside of your dress when it comes to the hem. But of course there is another option. The point is that you just need to make sure the hem stays up. So you can use something like wonder tape to hold everything in place and then slip stitch it by hand. That's also a really good option for an invisible finish. The last step in making the dress is to do the sleeve cuffs. So here, this is my front body with the facing. And I've just gone through and remarked these notches in since I lost them whilst I was overlocking. So you can always just take your pattern pieces out and you'll need the notch, which is 1 centimeter in from the raw edge. And then there are 4 notches consecutively. So we're going to fold over the raw edge to the wrong side by 1 centimeter. So I've pressed that already. And now we're going to fold it at this notch and then stitch it down. So there's a notch on the top of the sleeve and the bottom of the sleeve. So I'm just going to pop a pin there so I know where it is. Okay, and then I'm going to fold it over like this. Okay, and take my pin out. Just put it on the other side. And then I'm just going to stitch all the way around here. So there is a diagram on the instructions to help you with that. So you can see that you are folding in at this particular notch. When you fold, your edge should meet the notch that is closest to the body on the diagram. That would be this one. And if you find you're not meeting it, or you're meeting it on one side and not the other, then I'd recommend that you just take a ruler and check the length of that. So this, in my case, is 8 centimeters. I'm just going to measure 8 centimeters here, and then 8 centimeters from the top. So this is currently at 7.5, so I haven't folded it over enough. So my notches were not 100% accurate, or my folding point wasn't 100% accurate. So you can see where that should be over here. I've now stitched the cuff, so I folded the sleeve over back on itself and stitched it down where I had pinned before. And now I'm going to turn the dress over to the right side so that I can finish the cuff. So you can feel where the end of the cuff is, and you can also see the line of stitching there. So you can just fold it back so it meets the stitching. Do that on matching it at the seams. And you've got a couple of options here depending on how you like your cuff. I like mine fairly loose, so I might just tack it in place. So you can do it by hand or by machine. Just put a few stitches on the seam. So this is the shoulder seam, and I'm going to do the same on the underarm seam. And then you can either leave this loose or just put a few stitches here. Personally, I think it will look nice if you do it by hand rather than having a few hard machine stitches here, but that's entirely up to you. And that is all the construction steps of this dress.
I hope that you've enjoyed watching the sew along for the Style Arc Adeline dress, and that it's been helpful to you in making your own version. If you have any comments or questions, then just pop them into the boxes below and we'll get back to you as soon as we can. Don't forget, you can also follow Minerva for more posts on videos and videos on fabric and tutorials and things like that to keep your sewing inspired. And of course, here at Minerva, we'd love to see what you make as well. So if you want to make an account, it's free. You can post your own creations and connect with others in the Minerva community worldwide. Finally, I'm just going to show you a full view of the Adeline dress so that you can see what it looks like. Let me stand up. So here's my pockets. I think it's a really nice shape in the cocoon, and I'll turn around. And that's it. Thank you ever so much for watching, and we'll see you next time.